She probably tops me on those issues, but we also include solutions to those issues. I'm talking about Miss Lanita Duke. Lanita's been around issues for, as far as I'm concerned, all her life, including family.
That's high praise.
but this is going to be great because I'd never known that she would be interested in running for office, and so we, not only are we going to get the answer as to why she's running, but we really appreciate the fact that she is, because as you know, we are sort of in a crisis kind of an environment here at this point in time. Our youth are having major problems, our education system, safety in the streets, I mean, just on and on and on and on. And so it's going to be a pleasure to interview her and give you the opportunity to understand where I'm coming from, because I've always maintained that, especially I've run for office on a number of occasions, there's some things I've learned. And they will give you just enough time within 2 minutes to come up with not only the issue, but also a solution. And you just can't very well articulate an issue and at the same time talk to a solution. And that's really one of the problems. Hopefully we might be able to change that at some point in time, where maybe the filing, if you will, would be in such a fashion where a person would be required, if you will, to at least identify an issue on the filing form and at the same time identify a solution. And then that'll kind of give folks the opportunity to know exactly where these folks are and help the media. The media really needs help, because otherwise it's just a bunch of trivia. Mm-hmm. And it's not really talking about the main issue. So I'd like to introduce you. Thanks for coming.
Yeah,
appreciate
you're
that.
Very welcome.
This is great. Well, let's because we got enough time.
Okay.
We're going to have enough time.
Okay.
And I want to make sure that they're giving you the opportunity to let the voting public know who you are, because like I said, you go back a long way dealing with all these issues. So let's talk a little bit about Lanita.
Well, my name's Lanita Duke, and for years I'm news director and producer of Grassroots News Northwest.
Yes.
I'm a video educational producer. Ironically, I spent the 1990s here at Cable Access, when it was called Cable Access. What is it called now? Portland Media?
Portland Media, PCM, Portland Cable
okay,
Media.
Okay, well, this was back in the day in the 90s. And I learned a lot of my audio and video skills here. And prior to that, since 1979, I was a broadcaster on cable community radio. So
yeah, right.
I have a background in independent journalism. Mm-hmm. And it's that background that I was able to cover many issues affecting Portland's inner northeast area, and then larger issues such as economic development. I've always been a fan of education. In fact, you know, Ronnie Herndon would kill me if I did not constantly address the academic discrepancy that exists here in Portland.
Right.
We have an achievement gap, and what that means and the way it manifests itself through a child from kindergarten all the way through high school. So let's say, and it's not just African-American children, just children of color.
That's right.
If you graduate from the Portland Public Schools and you find yourself then at PCC, mm-hmm. and you take a placement test to find out where you are in math and mm-hmm. English and writing, and you'll be surprised to find out how much you do not know. You'll be surprised to find out that you need remedial classes. Mm-hmm. And I hear that a lot, and the problem is that you spend all your financial aid, your first 2 years at community college, taking remedial classes that by the time you're in your second year of community college, you're just at 100 level classes, which are transferable classes. But guess what, Bruce? Your financial aid is gone.
Oh, wow. Wow. Wow.
So unless you know how to play sports really, really well, unless you can bounce that ball with flavor, you're going to have some trouble. And I think that's why we have so many people who drop out of school. School is very daunting. I went to PCC, then I went to Merrill Hirsch University, and I could say that the study that I had to undergo at PCC was much more rigorous mm-hmm. than at Merrill Hirsch mm-hmm. College or Merrill Hirsch University. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people, they go to community college and they transfer to a university. And again, the problem is that by the time you take transferable classes, 100-level classes, 200-level classes, all your financial aid is gone.
Yeah. Well, look, let's go back a ways since I'm going to take advantage of this situation. You mentioned Ronnie Aspect.
Oh, yeah, I love Ronnie.
And Ronnie has been very much, he was very, very much involved in the education.
Yes, he was.
But he was there.
And he still is.
And he still is at the beginning. In fact, we're going to get him on the show.
You
got to get back in the deal because he jumped in there. When I think about him, I think about... Reverend John Jackson. He recognized
Reverend John Jackson.
Black United Front.
Organizing people of the faith community
regular
folks.
Exactly.
I mean, to me, he was a sterling leader.
Well, the Head Start thing. That's what I'm saying about it. Let's go back a minute.
Head Start.
Because
okay.
he noticed the difficulties, if you will, the whole issue of the system, because you would think that during those formative years, the idea is that once you've gone through this educational cycle during the formative years, you're ready now for the world. Mm-hmm. But the recognition on that front end that was very, very much important, getting an IE Head Start. Remember that one?
Yeah.
And Head Start, with all due respect, was in the churches.
It started right there in the churches.
With the parents and this, that, mm-hmm. and the other. Mm-hmm. And then John got involved, naturally John got involved in the deal. And then all of a sudden, this thing all evolves.
Well, let me just do
a simple correction.
You know, I have a degree in history, okay?
Right. Okay, go on.
History and culture. So Reverend Jackson and Ronnie Herndon and the Black United Front, their first issue that they tackled was education. And what they did, there was a busing program here in Portland, Oregon, that bused African-American children to Hayhurst School, to different schools, mm-hmm. just so that there'd be one person of color in the classroom. Now, this was during the 80s. Mm-hmm. So that was an extremely unfair busing program. And they bused children for no reason other than because of the color of their skin. Mm-hmm. So it took the efforts of the Black United Front, Ronnie Herndon and the faith community, and a number of other community activists. In fact, that's where Avell Gortley got her start, mm-hmm. too, as an activist. It took all that effort. There was a boycott May 19th, 1980. And it was the day that it was right after Mount St. Helens blew, because mm-hmm. I think Mount St. Helens blew May 18th, 1980. Then there was a school boycott. And not only did people of color keep their children home, but overall many families kept their kids at home because they felt that that was an unfair busing program. Mm-hmm. And it took people like that, activism like that, to dismantle that busing program. And I covered all that as a reporter.
I know that.
So those were exciting times. And then to do all that, to sort of take back your community, and then bam, guess what happened? Crack cocaine came into the neighborhood. Yeah. Now, I don't know about you, and I was making a speech a couple weeks ago, but I can't grow crack cocaine in my backyard. Mm-hmm. I grow daffodils right now. I got my tulips and my phlox coming up, but I can't grow crack cocaine. So crack cocaine was brought into the community. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And people got sprung on it. So there was not that sensitivity. Now there's an epidemic of meth and heroin. Mm-hmm. We call it heroin, right?
Yep.
So there's a concern now about treatment, getting access to treatment, mm-hmm. treatment on demand. Well, back then, they dealt with drug addiction in the Black community as a criminal justice issue. Mm-hmm. So that's why we have that crime bill, and we have a rise in incarceration. And you hear a lot of people talk about the disproportionate number of African-American males incarcerated mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. over a couple of vials of crack cocaine. Mm-hmm. But it just destroyed our community. And what bothered me is that you had people who just got out of poverty, just buying their first home, mm-hmm. their family wealth tied up in their property. All of a sudden, I'm not talking about grandparents now, but all of a sudden, their grandkids come along and they turn that beautiful home into a crack house.
Yeah.
So raising my family, it appeared and it seemed like there was a crack house on every block. It seemed like that way. It was probably a crack house on every few blocks, every mm-hmm. couple blocks. But it was devastating to us in the 1980s, and property values plummeted. Mm-hmm. And there are people to say that it was allowed to plummet. Mm-hmm. And what went on, and I went back east a couple times, I won a bunch of journalism awards. Mm-hmm. So I would go back east, and I would see the same thing in Harlem happening there mm-hmm. as it happened here in so-called Albina, mm-hmm. where you right next door to downtown, easy to get to the airport, centrally located, prime piece of property, plummeted because of crime and drug abuse.
And then there's Rico. Rico came in during that particular
Rico
time.
Rico came in as a reaction to it.
Exactly, exactly.
How
a lot of folks
moved
down. A lot of folks lost their homes.
They lost their homes, that's right.
And I can still remember when the guys were buying, guys who were basically pushing, because like you said, it wasn't manufactured in the community.
Right.
It came into the community aspect of it. But a lot of the things were confiscated, remember that?
Yeah, but you know, at the same time, this neighborhood was redlined.
Yeah, right, exactly.
And that I could get a loan from a bank to buy a Cadillac, but I couldn't refinance my home because these banks were not giving loans to people that lived in certain zip codes, that your insurance, your homeowner's insurance was higher if you lived in certain zip codes. So this area was redlined. And the property values plummeted. Then all of a sudden, developers took a look at it and said, hey, this is prime real estate.
Well, I remember that real well because I was kind of like gotten into the business with the plumbers. And we were actually basically doing a lease option purchase aspect of it. And then all of a sudden, Habitat for Humanity came in and put us out of business. I mean, I'm just saying, but my point is that the idea was to push home ownership, but that wasn't into the cards. The other thing that I want to ask you about, and I'm sure you've done some work along that line, the voc ed situation. You know, you had Benson, but they would never expand Benson to fit all the rest of the schools in the Portland Public Schools. Is any thought, any?
Well, my daughter went to Benson, and she didn't want to go. She wanted to go somewhere else. But I wanted her to go to Benson because I wanted her to get a good technical education. I wanted her to take advantage of the voc ed part of Benson. And she was there for about 2 years. And it's that combination of training and vocational education that you need. You know, I work with so many people just getting on the computer. To many people, they're afraid of it because it's a foreign kind of thing. They're not used to it. And it goes back to education. You have to be able to read and write very well. You have to be able to follow a set of instructions. Even in video production, I'm just humbled by how fast things have changed. When I started down here, we edit linearly, where you have a beginning, middle, and end. And we used to edit on an edit board. And now things are done in the computer with certain software. You just load it in, and it doesn't have to be linear. You can start, you can finish the beginning at the end of the video production, and you can do the middle somewhere else. And that's what we call nonlinear editing. Now, to be able to do that, you have to be familiar with computers. You can't be afraid of it. And you have to have the ability to learn and internalize the learning. And then everything you've learned, you have to be able to top it off with something else because everything you've learned now is obsolete. This technology is just crazy.
Well, you know, that's why I make that point about voc-ed and why it was so important, because it developed the enthusiasm, if you will, and the motivation, if you will, to want to learn, as you say, the reading, writing, and arithmetic aspect of it. But with that not being there, all of a sudden now you're sitting in a situation where young people have nowhere to go but the criminal justice system.
Well, no, I disagree with that.
Talk to me.
That's not the only place where they can go.
Okay.
All right.
Well.
That is not. I'm not going for the okie doke. That's not the only place they can go. Bruce, what's wrong with you? They can do other things.
You haven't changed. I like it. I like it. Go on.
Other options.
Give me some options.
Well, you're a military man.
Oh yeah. Well.
I think the military is a vital alternative for some men and women, young men and young women, who have the discipline to survive basic training.
Well, that's the ultimate voc-ed. See?
Yeah, that
input.
Is the ultimate voc-ed.
Input, output, and throughput.
Their training programs.
Oh, yeah, very much so.
I have to give props to my grandmother. She was autodidactic. You know what that means,
hey,
bro.
Now you're the educator. I mean, tell me about it.
My grandmother had the ability, and she taught me these skills. You have to have the ability to teach yourself. If you're interested in a certain topic, like you've always been interested in audio and video production, so you're able to pull all this together. Now, you don't have a degree in this, do you?
Nope.
You have the ability to teach yourself. So I think young people, they need to have options. They need to have people that can light a fire under them. They can have the ability to teach themselves. I saw a young man, and I have a background in social service, saw a young man I used to work with, and I asked all young people this, especially those that enter the juvenile criminal justice system. Yeah. I said, well, is there anything we could have done to stop your behavior? And it just breaks my heart because 9 times out of 10, they say no. This is something I had to do. I said, okay, I'm listening to you. I'm trying to learn. So tell me why. Why would you turn us down? And the cat gave us props, all the social workers props, and said, you guys did the best you could. I, as an individual, was not listening. And I asked him, well, why? And he said he didn't want to. Based on his background, he said he grew up too quickly. And it's odd that we're having this conversation because I met this young man today. And one of my campaign platforms is bring back community policing. Bring community policing back so you know who you are, who's in this neighborhood. You know Jamal, you know Jose, you know Alicia.
That's the way it was, you know.
Yeah, you know Moesha, you know these children,
that's right, exactly.
And you know their parents.
Yep.
And you're able to ameliorate some of this petty criminal behavior that we're being subjected to again. So, you know, we talked earlier about the Bureau. If I win, and I want to win, if I don't win outright, I want to force the incumbent into a runoff. I would like to take the police bureau, and I would like to bring back community policing.
What's your definition of community policing?
Again, where you know the people that you're policing and they know you. I'm going to tell Officer Johnny, you said that, you know, where people know you.
But
where you have an understanding.
We were doing that at one point in time.
Well, at one
time. What happened? What happened?
I think the priorities changed. That's what happened. The priorities changed.
What?
People retired. People no longer knew. You know, I used to hang out with Chief Moose up here at the...
Well, first African-American chief, right?
First African-American chief. I used to hang out with him up at the King Neighborhood Facility. There was this table in the middle, and I would be there, Edna Robinson would be there, Sharon McCormick would be there, Gail would be there.
Don't forget Gloria.
I'm not going to forget Gloria. I apologize. Don't want to forget anybody. Ronnie Herndon would come up there. And he would get a flavor for the community. He'd be able to see people. We would have meetings with the police and various police officers. And I think Ronnie Herndon and his organization, the Black United Front, helped the police to the extent that they were able to identify problems. Look, we got this crack house over here. Miss Johnson can't get to sleep. People running in and out of her house all hours of the night. What can you do, Officer John? Well, Officer John can watch that house, send a couple snitches up in there, close it down. To me, that's community policing.
That's community policing.
Right.
You think that's anything, would it be current, if you will, in your definition of community policing to date?
Well, I think you still have to have a relationship with the community.
Okay.
You have to have people that the community feels comfortable talking to.
Right.
You have to open at least the door to community policing, and you have to be seen. You can't be in those cars all the time. And it can't be such an adversarial relationship. And that's why we have this whole issue with Black Lives Matters, you know. When the police stop me, I kid you not, I'm afraid for my life. That's why I drive a raggedy Volvo. For real, because when the police stopped me, I said, oh, officer. And I made a video about this entitled
really?
No Drama, How to Have Positive Interaction with the Police.
Well, expand a little bit on that.
Well, when the police stop you, you do whatever they say.
Okay.
You know.
Okay.
And the issue is, even when you follow their directions, you still get treated differently. I read in, and this is a national issue, where an African-American woman came out with an axe. The police shot her dead. In the next day, a white guy, he's in on his front yard drinking beer. I think he's either naked or almost naked with a knife, and he gets arrested. So when people talk about Black Lives Matter, that's what they're talking about. You treat me with the same respect and dignity because you operating as a state authority. But at the same time, I understand other people to say, well, why don't Black Lives Matter increase what they're talking about, like in terms of, you know, being a parent, how you treat each other. Richard Sherman, that football player, he talked about how, well, you know, Black Lives Matter. The person that robbed me, hurt my family, that was an African American. My life didn't matter to him. So that's a complicated issue. But that's what that means, that whole Black Lives Matter.
That's been something that has not, again, as you say, there's sort of a negative kind. It's still sitting at sort of a divide. You know, just recently, Portland Community College came up with a White Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of gelled and this, that, and the other. But where it's at right now is just sitting on the table now again. And I would agree with you that we need to come together.
Absolutely.
And community policing is very, very important.
Yeah, we need to help the police. They obviously need all the help they can get. You got young men who are full of hatred and self-hatred. And, you know, I can't get a job. My car is raggedy. Yeah. I don't have a place to live. Mm-hmm. But this other Black man who looks like me and I know him disrespects me, so I'm going to take a gun and pop. Mm-hmm. Well, that puts all of us at risk. Mm-hmm. And if you look at it that way, I think that's one way to address it. And plus, I think the police know who engages in all this behavior. Mm-hmm. Those cats probably are on probation, just got out of jail. Mm-hmm. You know, they know who's doing this.
Well, let's talk about that a bit, you know, in terms of the folks that have basically gone through that whole incarceration aspect of it. A lot of times they come back, there are no jobs to begin with.
Right.
You know, when they are in sort of that control environment aspect of it, they have the opportunity, if you will, to pick up that GED during that particular time, or maybe even a skill. Remember, they went through that process. But it's an option to them. Mm-hmm. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, it should be mandatory. If they don't have a GED, guess what? They should go to school. I mean, why in that control environment, you know, a lot of times they'll say, well, okay, fine, we'll assign you over here to mop the floors or this, that, and that, and they do it with no problem. Okay. But there's this openness, if you will, to say, well, if you don't want to go to school, you get my rip? Mm-hmm. And then the other thing is that the fact of the matter is that they've all committed the crime, did the time aspect of it. So if they've got the education aspect of it, some way, shape, or form, they got to get into sort of a job environment thing. And then I've always maintained the trades are the way to go.
Yeah, I agree.
The trades are the way to go.
You're right, Doc.
And they can get
apprenticeship
the institution. And in all due respect, the specific trades is labor.
And at the same time, I don't think the trades should just be for folks who are incarcerated.
No,
I'd like to see those same trades out here. Furthermore, I'd like you're right.
Voc Ed, right there in the school system.
I like to see retraining of people over 40 and 50. Yeah. I hear a lot of folks over 50 who say, or especially those over 60 who say, well, I'm going to retire early because I don't believe anyone will give me a job because of my age. So, you know, when we talk about job discrimination, no one seems to want to talk about age discrimination in jobs, but it happens. Mm-hmm. So one of the reasons why I'm running.
Yeah, let's talk about your running. I want more. There's some other stuff I want more, because I would like to for you to have spent a little time in your writing skills when you were down at the Observer newspaper.
Right. Well, you know, I'm a journalist. Yeah, I'm
a
straight up journalist.
How'd you get in that business? I want to get into that a little bit.
Well, I started Grassroots News because there was no way an organization like the Oregonian would hire someone who didn't have a college degree. And it goes back to being autodidactic. Mm. So I started Grassroots News in 1979. I started writing for the Portland Observer.
Like Glory was the mentor, so to speak.
Right, right. And then I started doing radio with KABU in 1979. There was a gentleman named J.W. Friday. He would do a show on Saturday. He's still around.
I'm still missing.
He's a preacher now.
I know that.
It's amazing. So he would do a show, and he'd play a lot of popular music of that time.
Right.
And then I would come on and do news. And that's how I got started. And rather than say I'm from KABU, I'd say, well, I'm from Grassroots News Northwest. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Because I wanted something for me. And I'm glad I did that, because not only do I have it, my daughter has it. And I have a grandbaby now, which I'm tripping about.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Yeah, I always say she came from the planet Venus, but she lives on the planet Earth with us.
Wow, awesome.
But she's able to have Grassroots News, too. So for us, it's a family business.
Oh, cool.
And yeah, I just started.
You should have brought it on. You got to bring it on. You know what I mean?
They live in Pennsylvania.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, because I believe in that two-parent
grandma,
family.
Okay,
so
okay, good enough.
Anything to, you know, maintain the family.
Okay. Let's talk about now your race. Now, first off, why now?
You know, I was downtown. I was pitching an idea. This true story. I pitched an idea to the Portland police about doing another no drama, how to have positive interaction with the police.
Right.
Because I really believe in community policing.
Right. Okay.
And the nice thing about being an independent journalist, I can make things happen.
Yep.
It affects a small amount of people, but I can still make things happen. I want to make things happen now for the entire city. So I'm down there. I just left the police department pitching my idea. I walk down the street, and lo and behold, there is a tent on the sidewalk next to an empty building. And I'm thinking, there is something wrong with this picture. Here you have people, human beings, sleeping on the street next to an empty building in downtown Portland, one block from the police department. I was incredulous. So that's why I decided to run.
Okay. Okay.
And then I've had people come to me and say, you know, Lenita Duke, you have name familiarity. Mm-hmm. You know, I am not perfect. Lord knows I'm not a perfect person. But they say that you should run. You should think about running. And I said, well, you know, I should, shouldn't I?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I think timing had a lot to do with it and seeing that. And the whole issue of affordable housing, I think I can really address that issue.
Mm-hmm.
And there needs to be some creativity applied to that issue. For example, I think we should use some of our lottery money, our lottery funds, on developing affordable housing. And the whole issue of affordable housing, it's not just a Multnomah County, Portland, Oregon issue. It's a statewide issue.
Mm-hmm.
And those lottery funds are statewide money.
Mm-hmm.
All it takes is a legislator to write it up, bam, vote on it.
Mm-hmm.
This is a real problem. Back in the day, and you know, I've been here, I've been in Portland since the dinosaurs roamed the earth, right? Been here all my life. But I tell you, my first crib, I lived on top of stuff, you know? I used to live on top of a cleaner's. And then I lived on top of a bookstore. And I could get a crib for a couple hundred bucks a month.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have to go to the government to sign up for, you know, Section 8 or Housing Authority. I was just able to do that. And now those options are gone. There are no, like, real inexpensive places that's safe and clean to live.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got to remember something now. You remember we've gone through the baby boomer situation, right?
Okay.
And the baby boomers now are seniors, right?
Right.
And they've got their kids. And baby boomers, you got a lot of kids.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of folks went to school. You know, and then we progressed, if you will, to a certain degree. And all of a sudden, the income level for that particular group has grown so fast.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've sort of the left behind folks to a certain degree that wasn't part of that progressive entity aspect of it.
Now, I don't see the income going up. I see the income going down. I see the kind of high-paying jobs that people get. Very few people are getting
the high-tech parts, yeah.
Yeah, high-tech people are getting
it. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You read where different startups are getting millions of dollars, and yet you have this family can't find a place that's less than $900 a month, and their monthly income is $1,000.
Mm-hmm.
So what does that do for economic development,
mm-hmm.
Bruce?
Mm-hmm.
No, for real.
Well, you
spend all your money on finding a place to live, buying some food, and that's it. And another issue that's going to sock it to the voters here in the city of Portland, their utility bills.
Yeah.
It's not getting any lower. It's going to get higher, in fact.
Well, I think that's the importance, if you will, of getting the right leadership, if you will, with city council in those kind of arena.
Well, I understand you're running for mayor.
I'm running for mayor on the same format that you're talking about.
You're running for community policing and affordable housing.
That's right. The homeless aspect of it. And again, my thing is making sure that people are at the table. And we've developed, if you will, as far as I'm concerned, we got 100 neighborhoods or so in the city of Portland.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got 7 neighborhood associations, which is a composition of some of the neighborhoods, if you will. But again, a lot of those folks are just sitting around the table talking about their issues, but that particular area doesn't necessarily have the same issue as another area. They all vary to a certain degree, but they're all in one pot right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very hard. And depending upon whether or not your money or your power aspect of it, that's what tends to get at the top of the entity aspect of it.
Okay, so you're talking about at-large voting. And in the city of Portland, we have at-large voting. And we have a mayor and four city commissioners. Yep, now, exactly. I'm running for city commissioner, position one. I'm running against Amanda Fritz.
Right.
Now, you're talking about what they call single district, single member districts, where the representation is broken down by district. And I agree with that. I think that in the future, Portland needs to reevaluate, should we continue with at-large voting? And I think that we've grown beyond that. If we had single member districts, some of the issues that we're facing now would have been addressed. Mm-hmm. The whole issue of affordable housing and people experiencing homelessness, that has always been a sore in the city of Portland. Mm-hmm. But now the sore is infected. Mm-hmm. It's gone from Burnside. Remember, there used to be just a few blocks on Burnside. Yep. It used to be a Mississippi Street. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden it spread out. And one of my other issues is to make sure that the city of Portland doesn't dump in East County the way they treated inner Northeast Portland through displacement and gentrification. And the real issue that those people that are making bank, that can afford their mortgage and have, you know, disposable income after they pay all their bills, that's a wonderful thing. But this whole issue of people not being able to afford to live, people not having any disposable income, the whole class issue, Portland has to address that. Portland's never had to address that up front. They've had to address it on the QT, but they've never had to address it up front, and now they have to address it. Mm-hmm. And I want to address it. You even said bringing everyone to the table.
Yeah, that's exactly what you've got to do.
And now ESCO is going, broke my heart. ESCO, remember that manufacturing? They are going out of business. Yeah, what kind of manufacturing job that pays $70,000 a year to heads of household, mainly males heads of household, is leaving Portland? We should be out there protesting, getting them to stay.
Well, you know, as one would say, we've developed the world, we've educated the world, and many of those folks went back to their homeland, like China and whatever, and everything you see when it comes to metal and the other, guess what? Made in China. You see what I'm saying? So nowadays, the entities outside of our country, for that matter, are basically, when they order something now, they said, okay, fine, this is how we're going to order. The raw material is going to come from us, and we're going to bring it over to you. Or in most cases, we're going to take the raw material, and it's going to China, and we're going to use our labor force to do that piece. Mm-hmm. So we've got to be a little bit more creative. And that's why I'm saying that a person with your background and folks like that, with reference to your background and all, because you've been dealing with issues so much, and as part of dealing with those issues, you have to come with solutions. You just can't just sit there and talk about these issues. I mean, you got to be able to come with some form of solution. That means you got to get folks together to agree, to understand that, hey, look here, we got to have jobs here.
Well, I just wonder why no one from the city went to ESCO and tried to keep that. Well, and that's not the only manufacturing plant that Portland has lost.
That's right. Well, in all due respect, you're right. I mean, you just can't, and we are getting an influx of folks in this city, big time, okay? But where are the jobs?
Yeah, where are the good paying jobs?
Where are the good paying jobs?
I can always ask you, do you want to supersize that? But there are other, we need other kinds of higher paying jobs. Mm-hmm. I think affordable housing wouldn't be a crisis the way it is now if we had jobs paying $20, $25 an hour, where you can afford rent $1,500, no biggie, and you still have $1,000 left at the end of the month for disposable income, so you could, you know, enjoy your life.
And we got to motivate employers, because it's like anything else, they got to be able to make a profit.
They
got
to
be able to make
that.
A profit. And so the idea is, one has to be articulated enough to be able to understand that, so that when they're dealing with employers outside of our city, for that matter, they got to understand, they got to make sure they're dealing with the right employer. So that the dollars match up with, as you say, with the income, because if it doesn't, you're giving away too much, because you're basically making deals with businesses, saying, hey, look, why don't you come to the city of Portland? Here are the benefits, etc. But at the end of the day, is that, am I making 3%? Am I making 4%? Am I being able to make a living at the same time and make a profit for my efforts?
You and I are both capitalists. I believe in progressive capitalism.
But people need to understand that.
Yeah,
see, a lot of times, you see a business and all of a sudden it's just, well, gee whiz, we need to boycott this, we don't like this, this, that, and the other. I'm involved with the situation on Foster Road aspect of it. That's a major issue out there. You got businesses along the boulevard aspect of it. Folks want to change things, they want to change their lifestyle, bike lanes, this, whatever, whatever. But the fact of the matter is, you got to make sure you give consideration to the employee that's sitting there.
Look what's happening to, what is that, Precision Cast Parts?
Yeah, oh yeah.
They've
been
in the city for years providing jobs. Yeah. And now because of the affordable housing issue, you have housing encroaching upon an industrial area. Mm-hmm. And now people are saying, well, there's chemicals in the water. Mm-hmm. Well, that's because you're right next to a manufacturing plant.
Chemicals in the air, right, exactly.
Chemicals in the
air. But consideration should have been given at the time when they did this piece to make sure that houses shouldn't be as close or whatever.
But we still need businesses.
Oh, we need businesses.
You
need businesses.
Absolutely.
And if they're running away and right in front with it, every city in this state, in the country, are vying for that kind of business.
Yes, they are.
So, you know what I'm saying? They're looking at the schools for their kids. It's like anybody else. But the bottom line, if they're an employer, we want to keep them motivated enough to come to this city
and
expand,
stay here.
And stay here.
And stay here.
And stay
hire
here.
Local people.
And stay
it's
here.
Another issue I have with the city that when you, in their procurement, you know, when they give out contracts, make sure those contracts go to local businesses because that dollar stays in the community. Even if they have to create something locally to get a material completed, let that stay in the community. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there was a local business that could make those little parking meters that charge you $1,000 a minute to park. They could have done that. That money could have stayed in this community.
But a lot of times, if you look at the stamping at the bottom of the plate of that, it says made in China or made in Taiwan or this, that, and the other. And so I guess that's why it's so important to get the right leadership in the city council, people like yourself and maybe because we got the background. You know, I've been in construction for a long time.
Well, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
You set aside another issue,
exactly.
Like the voters pamphlet's going to come out, and I list all the things that I'm for. I said to get rid of the Office of Equity that my opponent is in charge of, because first of all, it's not doing anything.
No, that's right.
They hired this cat that's just a figurehead.
That's right.
He's not doing anything.
Right.
It's like, because of institutional racism and sexism and ageism here in the city. Mm-hmm. But we have an Office of Equity, and they trot this cat out. And what bothered me, even the Oregonian read an article on it a few weeks ago, said that people were upset with it because here you have a committee, you have citizens involved, and they give you ideas, and you don't do anything.
Yeah, right.
So just abolish it. It's a waste of money.
Well, you know, another one, I'm sure you can appreciate this also, too. I spent a lot of time in the whole issue of the set-asides.
Okay.
Back when Perrin Mitchell, if you will, basically, that's who basically introduced it. And I met with Perrin at that time, and he said, these are very, very important times, because they use the highway funds. Mm-hmm. That's where he was, because he was on that committee aspect of it. And he made it very clear to me at that point in time. He said, Bruce, you got to make sure that you got to get to those primes. You got to understand what this business is about. Mm-hmm. And start off with the jobs. Start off with the trades.
Mm-hmm.
But all of a sudden, you know, that naturally there were some entities that basically, let's go on and be contractors. We want to be prime contractors. That was, to me, a wrong move. I mean, people should have established themselves in a specific trade before they got out all of a sudden wanting to be contractors.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things I was thinking about was that on the whole issue of the so-called monies now, the set-aside aspect of it, because how do you get the system in a fairness way? Well, my thing is that we've got census tract. You know, we go around, identify the number of women, the colors, all that other, this, that, and the other. So if you're going to do 10% for women and minorities, then you use the census tract. It makes it easy aspect of it. And if a person does, you see what I'm saying? But when you use the census tract, make sure it's in the traits. Almost going back to voc ed.
Right.
I'm always going back to voc ed.
Well, you know, I appreciate you advocating for the trades. We certainly need the trades.
You know, but you are too, though.
Yeah, you know, again, you have kids. They can play a video game, but they can't operate basic software to get a job.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, these are very concerning issues. That whole, I keep going back to the academic gap and how it hurts us as a city and as a state. And I know it's not in the charter. The city of Portland's charter, they gave education. They like, we're not going to address this issue. We're going to give it back to the schools to address. It's like
with
youth.
Was that a good move?
Well, it's just like with youth. They gave the whole issue of youth employment to Multnomah County to address, and then nothing happened. Mm-hmm. And what George Carlin said, if you want to make sure nothing happens, just set up a committee.
Yep.
So let's set up a committee. Nothing will ever happen. So we don't have youth with summer jobs anymore, right?
That's right.
The city
is
not involved in education. And I keep harping, like I said, Ronnie Herndon would kill me if I don't use this platform to talk about the academic achievement gap that exists here in Portland. And then not just, not only does it hurt children of color, but it hurts all children. Mm-hmm. And these children grow up, they go to community college, and unless you can play basketball or football or some kind of sports really well, it's going to come back to bite you in the butt. You spend all your financial aid the first 2 years taking remedial classes.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden they say, well, you ran out of financial aid, and you're just now starting to get your academic groove.
Mm-hmm. Well, what do you think about the old way was 1 through 12, right?
Yeah, K through 12.
I really think that this is my thought, is that as far as the formative years, it should go up another 2 years, meaning a person picks up their associate degree when they graduate. So K through 14, let's say. But they could really consolidate some of that stuff and still do K through 12.
I don't know, man. Kids want to get out of school, bro.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, you could consolidate some of that and come up with a package at K through 12 where a person picks up an associate degree. We've become so sophisticated. We got these things here. We got smartphones. We got everything. I mean, you can get the entire education over that stuff. Fair?
Well, I think maybe in the 10th grade we should add some vocational education.
Oh.
Because I can't imagine children wanting to stay in high school for another 2 years. I don't want them
I want voc ed, you know.
But they talked about having that at one time here in Portland. They used the model in Germany, an apprenticeship program,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and it never flew. They got rid of it. So I think maybe in the 10th grade it'd be a really good
Because voc ed in my area was about 8th grade.
Program. Yeah,
but 8th grade was my, that's where I was in voc ed.
Yeah. Well, you know, back in the day, the city of Portland had a youth manpower program
mm-hmm.
where they had federal money and they would assign an employer to train a youth, and the city of Portland would pay that youth salary, and they would get some training, and they would be able to develop and build a resume beyond fast food. Now, I'm not denigrating fast food. I think all work is good. But it would be nice, like you said, in 10th grade to add some voc ed and add some computers.
Well, think about it now. Training. Think about it. At Jefferson High School, they used to have the TJ room. Remember that?
Mm-hmm, I do.
And all of the burger folks, those retailers mm-hmm. and whatever, would actually get, that's where they would get their employment. And then the kids would be able to eat, make a few bucks, learn how to take care of that deal, right? That's fair? See, so like I said, I'm getting right back. Ronnie's got to get to the table.
You got to
give him a call. And because in all due respect, history sort of...
It's repeating itself. And it's repeating itself with me in a sense that now I spent all those years behind the mic. Now I'm in front of the mic.
Exactly.
And it's a daunting task, Ronnie, and you know this, running for political office.
It's not an easy.
Especially if you work. Like, I still work.
Yeah, hey.
I work two jobs.
Hey.
And it is
restaurant.
Daunting.
I'm
yeah, look
restaurant.
How busy you are.
My wife had a hip replacement aspect of it, so I'm taking care of her too. And,
good for you.
And I'm
good
doing the
you.
Cooking, and I'm doing all kinds of good stuff. But that's okay.
Good.
That's okay. I feel good about this, people.
Well, you've been doing this for a very long time. You've been very consistent with it. And it's because you are a role model that says, yes, you don't have to be perfect to run for political office.
Right.
You don't have to feel that you have to tell all your personal business to run for political office.
You're still human.
You don't have to run up and down the street butt naked to say, look at me, look at me, look at me.
Yep.
You don't have to do any of that. And you hurled all that in by just being yourself, by being consistent, and you run each and every election year.
And you learn something.
Yeah, I mean, you're so cool about it now. And you're not like this godfather figure where I need to get Bruce Broussard's permission to run for political office.
Don't have to do that. In fact,
I've surprised a lot of people by running.
Well, I appreciate you being on it.
I'm really excited because my name is the first name on the ballot where it says City Commissioner Position 1, Duke. And I think this is so cool.
Well, I wouldn't have any problem, if you will, for a bureau as far as police commissioners. See, I wouldn't have to worry about it because I'll have other things to deal with.
Yeah, you have other things to deal with.
I'll be the downtown guy, making sure that the businesses come here. Got me? Making sure that we create jobs.
Well, you know, and getting back to affordable housing, you and I talked while we're in the green room, so to speak, about now the city needs to start building up.
Yes. Yes.
And that's going to change things. We're going to end up looking more like Seattle.
Yeah.
You go to Seattle, things are built up.
At least this part of the area. Yeah,
we need to build up.
You know, in fact, it may be a sore spot for
them. I'm talking about 6 and 7 stories.
Oh, very much so.
And have one floor dedicated to affordable housing. Yep. That's what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, I agree with you, and there may be business
on the bottom level
aspect. Yep. It just makes a lot of sense, and a developer could come up with a kind of a rendering that would really be nice and neat. I mean, to really think about it, but we got to do it now, and we've got to do it with smart people, not just people just taking the money.
Well, you know, and I have issues with us always looking to developers to solve our problems. We live in the city of Portland. We have a variety of people that own property. We have families who inherited their grandparents' mm-hmm, home, mm-hmm. and they moved to another area, mm-hmm. but they still own that mm-hmm, home, mm-hmm. and they use that for tax purposes mm-hmm. and to generate revenue. Mm-hmm. We need to reach out to the person that owns a duplex and a triplex. Mm-hmm. We need to reach out and work with the smaller developer as much as we do the large developer. Well, they need as much love from the city of Portland as those large developers. We need to look at zoning and be creative in how we use zoning.
Well, normally
laws.
The planning bureau is supposed to be there.
Well, that
but unfortunately, we got to beef that up. I mean, that's a whole different ball.
Well, look what the planning bureau absolutely destroyed inner Northeast Portland. Yeah. That's why we have gentrification and displacement. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a time in Portland where a woman could not walk up and down these streets without being propositioned as a prostitute. Mm-hmm. Now, that happened in my lifetime. And again, although I've been here since the dinosaurs roamed the earth, right? My daughter had to be subjected to that. But again, it took the activism of the Black United Front and the faith community to clean all that up. And this is among the things that bothers me about gentrification mm-hmm. is that the very people who cleaned this neighborhood mm-hmm. up, they were not able to benefit from the neighborhood mm-hmm. when it changed. They end up having to move further east, west, downtown. Many people just left Portland. Mm-hmm. And they were the ones that were out there marching and protesting to clean this neighborhood up. And they couldn't benefit from it.
Well, I think about the villa. Remember the villa?
I do remember the villa. Yeah.
And how they had said that people were going to move back in once they get in. But then what happened is that about a third or two-thirds of them are gone.
Well, they moved in other areas of Portland.
But still, my point is that that was their home then. And they just cleaned it up, but it didn't happen that way. But anyway, but my point is that we just all need to get together. And I think we've got some smart people here in this city, smart people in this state, and not look at just the pocketbook aspect of it. That's what I'm saying. We've been there, right? We want to give back.
Well, I'm really excited about the May 2016 election. There are a lot of new people in there, a lot of new faces, a lot of smart people.
Yes, very much so.
And the old guard got to go.
Yep.
The incumbents, they got to go. Even if you don't vote for me, the incumbent has to go.
Well, that's the lay of the land now, even from a national perspective, right?
It is.
No to the politician. And even they could change if they're allowed. My point is that how we were doing business, that's mm-hmm. the it. The individual, all he had to do is just come back to the table.
Right.
That's all, and start working and performing. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So what would be some of your statements, your last statements? What about the youth? In fact, one area we didn't touch on, mental illness.
Are you trying to call me crazy?
No.
Because you got to be crazy to run for political office. You got to be a little touched in the head.
I'm talking about the ones that are still trying to run. No, the mental illness. They constantly bring this up now. Because mm-hmm. as you know, at one point in time, the mental illness folks used to be in a house situation up in the Beaverton area, up in that area. But now they're on the streets. I mean, that's where it is. I mean, it's just basically giving you a pill and going on, et cetera.
Well, in the 80s, right? There was this push to deinstitutionalize the mentally ill. What happened was they deinstitutionalized them, but the dollars didn't flow where the bodies went, where the people went. Mm-hmm. So now we have a situation where jails are the new, and I think I said that in one of my candidate forms, the jails are now the new residential mentally mental health hospitals or jails and prisons. And then when they get out, they go back to the street. But what is interesting, and my campaign manager talks to me about this all the time, that you cannot experience homelessness, and the longer you're out there on the streets, you're going to become mentally ill. Because it's rough out there.
It's rough out there, but I've traveled those streets of late.
Yeah, so we're looking at, so in terms of treatment and the mentally ill, we're looking at treatment on demand. Mm-hmm. I'm suffering through a psychosis. Mr. Police Officer, please don't shoot me. In fact, the Department of Justice in 2015 came out with a report saying that for people experiencing a mental illness crisis, a psychosis, that when the police are called, they need to be accompanied by mental health specialists. Not, and then just don't shoot them because they're acting a certain way because you feel intimidated. So that's what the Department of Justice found and for found against Portland, to be more humane in how they treat the mentally ill, especially as they go through their crisis. But again, it gets back to treatment on demand. And we look at these agencies providing mental health treatment, you know, Cascadia and the other one. Are they doing a good job? Have they been evaluated? Has the city ever had an opportunity to look at how they're doing, what they're doing? And then in terms of treatment, is it just given meds? Are they just like a pill mill? So, you know, that whole issue is a really big issue, and not just mental illness, just A&D abuse, you know, alcohol and drug abuse.
And what about seniors like me? I mean, what am I going to do? I mean, after
well,
a while.
Well, you know, I really feel for seniors because you have people who lived in their homes. They're on a fixed income.
You got to remember me now.
They don't have a whole lot of hustle.
You got to remember me now.
You got to hustle, bro.
You got to remember me.
And they've worked all their lives, and they deserve to be able to walk down the street without fear.
Men and women both.
Sizing them up and thinking they're going to take advantage of them.
Exactly.
Absolutely not.
Exactly.
Absolutely
not. We can't forget our seniors.
And, you know, another thing that I see with seniors, not only are they having difficulty finding employment, they're being pressured to retire early. And the ones that are struggling, I had this great idea. I must say this was a brilliant idea, Ms. Duke. I had this idea where people are struggling to pay their mortgage. The city of Portland should set up a pilot program that will help them refit their home so they can have an extra bedroom to rent out. We kill two birds with one stone. We're able to help somebody on a fixed income maintain their property, pay their mortgage every month, at the same time provide a rental to someone.
We got to change that policy, you know.
The city can get, that's why I said there's no creativity in any of this.
Well, that's why
and there
so
needs to be. And that's why we need a change of leadership. So vote Duke for city council.
I like it already.
I have your vote?
You got my vote. Well, like I said, I mean, you're making my job a little easier, you know, because in all due respect, when running for mayor, it was a pretty big, it's a big
task.
Yeah,
why'd you pick mayor and not city commissioner?
Because I'm going to make sure that the four commissioners are going to be doing something, see? And then I can do my job better, i.e. getting jobs, getting business to come here.
So what do you feel about the men and women that are running against you?
Well, in all due respect, I'm sort of ahead of the game a little bit. I look at the list. I mean, they're neat folks and whatever. But the bottom line is that I wish they, like I said, on the application, on the filing form, they were able to identify their specific issue and also a solution to that issue. Because when I see them in those IE gatherings, if you will, they really don't have the time to talk about their issues. Because a lot of times the interview is kind of like either trivia or asking questions. They have no background.
I know, you have three minutes.
Yeah, three minutes, I mean, to solve this problem. Well, look, we got 47 minutes. But hey, you need to vote for this lady. I think she's going to be really good. I think I might have you as police commissioner.
Well, I appreciate
be all right with
that.
You on that.
That would
deal.
Be great, you know what I mean? Yeah.
And by the way, if in all due respect, you, as far as sometimes winning can be losing. You will not lose, if you understand what I'm saying. You got to stick with it. Fair?
That's fair, but I don't want to lose. I want to win. Do not necessarily want to go into a runoff. It would be lovely if I can win, you know, first round without going to a runoff. But if I have to force the incumbent, into a runoff, I'm willing to do that. But I only need one vote to win.
I understand. Lita, it's a pleasure.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Hey, thank you, Lita.
Bruce Broussard for mayor, Lenita Duke, city council, position 1.
Boy, she's great. I better have you in my seat.